course, I must thank the other members of the committee, and I must thank the honorary members of the team, Ron and Lissa. Well done, Ron and Lissa. But if you've any justice, the people who owe our greatest thanks are to Tracy and the Yellow Shirts. Not forgetting Cynthia and Nikki, who worked very hard with Tracy as well. They did a tremendous job, and that shows you what Scots hospitality is like. We didn't pay them nearly enough for the hours they put in. They're a terrific bunch, and I'm terribly grateful to them for all the work that went into it. Now, it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you tonight Scotland's leading legal academic and philosopher of law, Professor Neil McCormick. Well, that's two rounds of applause before you start, Neil. You're doing awfully well. Neil's CV is truly astonishing. He's currently the Regius Professor of Public Law and the Law of Nature and Nations at Edinburgh University. I believe his chair is no longer founded as one of his predecessors was by a tax of 1p on the price of every pint of beer sold in Edinburgh. But he seems to be surviving, whether it's funded by that means or not. He formerly taught at St. Andrews University and then at Oxford, where I had the great good fortune to inherit him as my supervisor when doing my DPhil there. He's the author of four books in the philosophy of law and has edited and co-edited many others. He's currently working on legal theory with reference to the problems of the European community. He's a scholar of international standing and reputation, has been a visiting professor in Sweden, Texas, Canada, Germany, Australia, and lectured in many other countries. He's an honorary graduate of several universities and an honorary fellow of one or two others. He's a member of the Research Council of the European University Institute. He's a former president of the Society of Public Teachers of Law. That's our leading learned body for academic lawyers in the UK. Vice president of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, our leading learned society in Scotland. He was elected a foreign member of the Finnish Academy of Sciences, vice president of the International Association of Philosophy of Law and Social Philosophy. And he was elected a fellow of the British Academy in 1986. Well, with a CV like that, you'd be forgiven for thinking that Neil was pompous or boring or both. Well, he's not. I asked him how to introduce him, and he said, or what his own self-description would be, and he said, well, just say I'm the intellectual vacuum cleaner from the East. His title of his talk is Law, Politics, State and Nation, Deconstructing the Sovereign State. But when I asked him what he was going to talk about, he said, oh, the usual conceptual stuff, taking each aspect of the title apart and seeing if you can put them together again. So can I ask you to lean back, fasten your seatbelts, hold on to your armrests, and wait for the magical mystery tour. Neil.
It's an awe-inspiring task to rise in this wonderful Gothic Revival interior and not be asked to give a sermon. It's a terrible pleasure to be here, back in my native city, actually within 200 yards of where my grandmother, my mother's mother, was born, and to see this wonderful restoration that Strathclyde University has made of one of our oldest and finest churches and turned it into a body with more mundane than divine purposes, but no doubt the mundane and the divine come together somewhat. I was very, very grateful indeed to Mavis McLean and the Research Committee on Sociology of Law for doing me the honor to ask me to give this talk tonight, and I want to say how much I admire the work she and they have done and the tremendous input they have put into this conference. And I do want to say my own personal word of thanks to all the yellow shirts, of course, but to Alan and Peter and Neil. I take a certain pride in seeing what a splendid conference this has been, because as Alan said, I was at one time one of his supervisors. I was at one time one of Peter's teachers in Dundee, and I at least sort of lived in the next room to Neil Hutton's supervisor, and claim a sort of osmotic influence on his work, but only that. When I said to Mavis what I would talk about, it was so long in advance that I wanted to have a biggish canvas, not that I could decide which bit of it to paint in on. And I met Martin Krieger and said, law, state, law, politics, state, and nation. Not much else, is there? He said, you've left out civil society. And I tried it out on Zenon Bankowski, and he said, you've left out God. Well, even so, I think that there's a reasonably large target area here. Before I go on, could I just say how grateful I am, on behalf of those of us who are trichologically challenged, to notice that the committee and the advertisers are supplying for us at the Baldy Center for Law and Social Policy in the State University of New York at Buffalo. I can't wait to get there and meet my colleagues. When I say I want to take apart the bits of the title, I suspect that there are ways of thinking which we're all familiar with, and all of us perhaps at least sometimes, and some of us all of the time, take rather for granted. That there's the easy identification of law and politics. Sometimes some aspects of critical legal studies want to make a particularly strong assertion that the legal is the political and the political is the legal. There isn't a gap between them. And of course, legal positivism really came out of that idea too. The law as the sovereign's command, Bentham and Austin. Want to say, nonsense all this stuff about natural law. Law is political through and through. It's what real rulers decide in real societies and in force. Then again, Austin himself says the state is really just another name for the sovereign. And the most interesting jurisprudential writer about the state, Hans Kelsen, asserts the identity of state and law. The state is just the law personified, or rather perhaps, the state is the personification in the eyes of the law of the law's organs of government. So the state and the law are really the same thing looked at in a different way. And finally, state and nation, the most common way of speaking, assumes an identity. Indeed, asserts the identity in the time-hallowed phrase, the nation state. And I suppose you might want to argue that one of the official ideologies available since the French Revolution, so the end of the old feudal monarchies and pre-modern monarchies, has been the idea of the state as nation, and the unity of the citizens of the state around a common ideal of nationhood has been one of the fundamental ideas of modern social and political thought and practice, perhaps more practice than thought. So law, politics, state, and nation sounds as though it's actually just one topic, not four, if these identifications all hold good. But I want to ask, do they? I want to do a bit of deconstructing. I want to take it to bits a little and see if we can put it back in a different way. And as Alan said, the subtitle is Deconstructing the Sovereign State. I think a very interesting thing is happening in Western Europe at the moment. And as Kim Shepherdley pointed out in the opening talk of the conference in the first plenary, spreading its tentacles, spreading its influence out over the other parts of Europe. And I think in some ways, perhaps, setting a new example, a new picture, which could perhaps end up having worldwide global influence. After all, the nation state, the sovereign state, was a European invention, for good or for ill, and was exported to the other parts of the world. Maybe if the inventors get fed up with it, other people will think it's not so good either. And I'm going to do this from the point of view of some ideas put forward by Otto Weinberger in Graz and myself that we called the institutional theory of law, or in his version of it, institutional positivism. I'm no longer sure that I want to call myself a positivist, and certain that I want to present a moving target on that issue. And coupled with an idea called liberal nationalism, which Yael Tamir at Tel Aviv and myself and one or two others have written about recently, which always gives a great sort of frisson of shock to your nice civilized friends who think that there could be no such thing. This is an oxymoron masquerading as a political view. You might just think, really, that this is all kind of analytical philosophy larded with old-style nationalism, just sort of Gothic revival. Well, if it is, this is a good place to do a Gothic revival lecture. Where to start? I promise not to go on too long, because I'm well aware that I'm the only thing that stands between us all and a good party. I'm also told that it won't be poured until 6 o'clock, so I can reasonably detain you for 35 minutes. I want to start with these rather sad events in Portadown, Northern Ireland, which have happened as this conference has been unfolding. Perhaps because we've all been at a conference, you haven't been seeing the television or reading the newspapers as much as you otherwise would, but the basic story is, at this time of year, the majority community in Northern Ireland, or persons from within it, have a long tradition of marches celebrating the victory of the Protestant forces in Ireland in 1692, the Orange Walks, they're called. And from the point of view of one conception of civil liberty, what these people are doing is exercising the ordinary liberty of free movement down the Queen's Highway, down the public roads of the country, asserting their presence there and demonstrating their loyalty to one set of political, cultural, and religious ideals. From another point of view, of course, they are expressing an unacceptable and almost, in some contexts, fascistic form of domination over the minority community in Northern Ireland, which in turn perceives itself to be a part of the majority community of the island of Ireland. Anyway, there was trouble last year in the town of Portadown when there was going to be a march. And this year, the Chief Constable of Northern Ireland exercised the statutory power to lay down that a march must not proceed down certain roads, but was to take an alternative route. And under public order legislation in force in all parts of the UK, Northern Ireland included, chief officers of police and others of a certain rank have the power to direct the route that a political or protest march must take, with a view to preventing public disorder. In this particular case, of course, the ruling not to go down the Garvachy Road itself tended to provoke disorder, because the marchers insisted that it was their historic and traditional right to go down that very road, and they lined up eyeball to eyeball with the police, and the police lined up eyeball to eyeball with them, and barbed wire was unrolled, and a standoff took place for 4 days, in the course of which there was a steadily increasing outbreak, or series of outbreaks, of violent protest in other parts of Northern Ireland. And on the 11th of July, at very short notice, the Chief Constable announced that he had revoked his earlier decision, was giving permission to the Orange Marchers to walk down these roads, and was therefore requiring the police force no longer to stop them, but to clear a way for them. And then, of course, instead of the police being eyeball to eyeball with the Protestant marchers, the police were now eyeball to eyeball with, and indeed shooting plastic rounds at, the Catholic residents, who were angered and protesting at what they saw as an invasion of their part of the town. Thereafter, there a controversy has broken out as to whether or not political pressure was brought to bear on Sir Hugh Ansley, the Chief Constable, to revoke his earlier decision and clear the way for the march. So here we have a situation where I think we can, interestingly, begin to start working out a contrast between the law, or a tenet, a conception of the law, and a conception of politics or of the political. When I think about law, I want primarily to put it within the category of normative order, some way of things being wrong or not wrong. Something which is identified as wrong is not to be done, and things which are not wrong may be done. More simply put, we would say that the division of right and wrong, but right and wrong are really contraries, not contradictories. So a normative order, then, is to be thought of as a kind of ideal order, isn't it? It's not how people exactly do behave, but how they ought to. It's an imaginary way of behaving which is partly realized and which people are expected to bend their wills to realizing better, and which officials are expected to reinforce the realization of. In that sense, we have the idea of law as a normative order, an order of right and wrong. In particular, though, an institutional, and therefore partly heteronymous, normative order. By contrast, with morality, personal morality, attendant on a Kantian conception of personal morality, which is through and through autonomous, the law is a normative order set for us via public institutions, perhaps ones in which, in a democratic society, we have a hand in or a vote in. But in the end of the day, what is required is what's decided, whether we would have gone along with the decision or accept it as autonomous agents or not. So law is normative order, institutional normative order. And within that kind of normative order, people can be put in the position where they can make something that isn't wrong become wrong, or that has been wrong become right. For example, under the legislation we're thinking about, the Chief Constable can, by a certain sort of decision announced in a certain way, make it wrong for marchers to exercise their ordinary liberty of walking down a certain street. As long as the decision stands unrevoked, it becomes a norm that you've not to go there, you're not to go there marching in an orange march. And of course, as it may be, and as in this case is, the person who has the power to lay on the norm has also the power to revoke it. Notice, of course, just because normative order is ideal order, it doesn't follow that it works. The order might have been unrevoked, and the marchers nevertheless pressed through after struggles and bloodshed with the police. So, within institutional normative order, we have this exercise of normative power, this exercise of authority, norm-creating power, which can affect ways in which people behave, is aimed at affecting ways in which people behave, but which doesn't, in the ordinary sense, have a direct causal influence on behavior. So we look at the events that happened, we can look at them, I think, in another perspective. We can say here there was a power play going on. We don't exactly know who all the power players were. We know for certain that the Orange Lodges in Northern Ireland showed their muscle, went out into the streets, made clear that they were ready to protest and press protest to an extreme. We know also that the present United Kingdom government depends for the security of its majority at the time being on the support of the Ulster Unionist Party. So it may be that both in terms of parliamentary politics and in terms of street politics, pressure is being brought to bear. As a result of that pressure, the legal decision is made. But here, we don't envisage the decision being made on the ground of some anterior normative order. I think what we have here is the idea of interpersonal power, the exercise and the interplay of interpersonal power. And I want to suggest, in the words of the late Anirudh Bevin, one of the greatest socialist thinkers or socialist politicians in post-war Britain. Politics is about power. When we think of politics, we essentially, in my view, are considering the exercise of interpersonal power in organized human communities. And politics is about its exercise. Perhaps we want to add one further thing. Politics is about power exercised in the context of some discourse or dialogue. A political solution to a problem in Ireland, a problem in Yugoslavia, differs from a military solution. And it differs exactly because, although force and coercion are available in the background, the effort engaged in politics is to bring about resolutions by discussion and decision taken reasonably, perhaps in an ideal way, with some thought of the common good of a community, supposedly, in principle, guiding the dialogue or discourse. So that is then politics, the exercise of power in a dialogical context. If that's true, it makes it possible for us, after all, to conceptually differentiate the legal and the political. Politics is an order of power. Law is an order of authority. Law is a normative order, institutional normative order. Once you say that, you see, I think, that taking any particular situation and asking legal questions about it is asking somewhat different questions from taking the same situation and viewing it in the perspective of politics. And this is how it should be, you might think. We, after all, have our universities subdivided into departments of politics or government and departments or faculties of law, and if they weren't doing something different, we shouldn't be paying them all. But I think it is true that there are these significant conceptual gaps. But we shouldn't mistake conceptual gaps for an absence of the most intimate interaction in real-world situations. Obviously, the decision what shall be the content of the normative order is grounded in some ideas about good political order, is grounded in some kind of political dialogue or discourse. And obviously, the durable maintenance of political power over time depends upon some sense of the legitimacy of the holding and exercise of power by whoever holds and exercises it, and by whatever means they do so. And as Weber pointed out so long ago, not only he, the ability to legitimize one's political decisions through the forms and structures of law is powerful medicine. So that the law can help to secure the legitimacy and thus the effectiveness of politics, and yet again, on the other side, without the backing of political power and the input of political debate, law would be not an effective institutional normative order, but purely some kind of merely ideal order. So they interact most intimately, and we all know that. But we shouldn't take that interaction to justify the simple assertion of identity, I don't think. We should be ready to see the difference and interaction. And there are, I think, particular reasons why we want to do that in the context of thinking about the next phase of this talk. That bit was, as it were, the first two words, law and politics. Now the state, or running them through first three, law, politics, and the state. Is the state a concept that we should ascribe primarily to politics, or primarily to law, or to both equally, or to both partially, to both in different perspectives? Hans Kelsen who is, I think, one of the few frontline recent contributors to philosophy of law to have thought about it with any real care, suggests the doctrine, as I said at the beginning, of the identity of law and state. When we conceive of the state in a legal context, we really conceive of the law as the incorporating order constituting a corporation. Legal order thought of corporately just is the state. In the 1960s in Britain, there was, of course, great controversy whether this country ought to have nuclear weapons, whether we should have a fleet of bombers armed with nuclear weapons, weapons of mass destruction. And in the time of that heated controversy, some brave people, brave and principled or brave and misguided, depending on your point of view, went and sat down on the runway at Wethersfield Air Base to try and impede the taking off of bombers. And they were prosecuted under the Official Secrets Act, which makes it an offence to enter upon government property for a purpose prejudicial to the safety or interest of the state. You can well imagine the case that the defence made. Prejudicial to the safety and interest of the state. What could be more dangerous to the people of the United Kingdom than to have these dreadful weapons, which guarantee that on the outbreak of war we will be the first target? We weren't acting prejudicially to the interest of the state, we were acting to save it. You can imagine what the judges said. Not for us to second-guess the decisions of the government. If the government, supported by majority in Parliament, decides that on balanced British defence policy requires these weapons to be used, it cannot be argued in a court of law that the interest of the state demands something else. And this is, I think, a kind of decision which is easy to bring within the perspective of that view of Kelsen's. When the law conceptualizes the state, somehow it's self-referential, it's looking at itself. But the thing came to a head even more in a later decision at the time of the Falklands conflict, when a civil servant obtained information which was embarrassing to the government, and in particular to the then Minister of Defence, Mr. Heseltine, about whether the battleship Belgrano was steaming towards or away from the Falkland Islands when the British Navy sunk it, torpedoed it. Well, this information was passed by the civil servant to a member of Parliament in the opposition side to enable him to probe more carefully the case that the government was putting up about its decisions. This time, he was prosecuted under the Official Secrets Act. On this point, he had passed information held by him as a servant of the Crown, servant of the state, to a person who was not authorized to receive it and to whom it was not his duty in the interest of the state to pass it. I'm quoting the terms of the Act. Again, the issue arose in the court of law. What is it somebody's duty in the interest of the state to do with official information? The trial judge said to the jury, I tell you this, the interests of the state are for the purpose of this court, whatever the government says they are. And if the government says it wasn't in the interest of the state to pass it to a backbench MP, that's the end of the story. The jury, however, acquitted the civil servant, evidently not believing what the judge said to them, thinking they had a better idea about the interests of the state, and that perhaps in a case like this, the proper constitutional order of the state is better understood in terms of the answerability of ministers before Parliament, and actions which serve the answerability of ministers before Parliament are in the interest of the state conceived in that way. Well, conceived in what way? Germans, I think, would give us the very clear and correct answer. The state conceived as a Rechtsstaat can't have an interest in the subversion of its own constitution. If the state is to be a state under law, a law state, the law has to be capable of imposing an independent control on state activity. Ah, this time, a gap opens up. Even in this legal discussion, a gap opens up between the law and the state. And I think the way to grasp at that gap is to go back to the first distinction, the distinction of law and politics, and say this: we ought to think of the state as primarily a form of political order, an order of power. Of course, we need to add a number of special qualifications, particularly that it is unitary and territorial power, power over a defined territory acknowledged by similar power holders similarly installed in other territories. Now, if it was correct, as we said a moment ago, that politics cannot be durably effective without the legitimation of law, not in modern societies anyway, then naturally it will follow that all states will, to some extent, use the ideology of law, will, to some extent, seek the support and comfort of the legitimizing effect of an acknowledgement of rights, an upholding of rights, and all the rest of it. They will at least purport to do that. But to take the next step, which Kelsen's theory forced him to take, and say, therefore, every state considered as such is a Rechtsstaat. The state being just the legal order personified, it can't be other than a law state. And so the very concept of Rechtsstaat, law state, is kind of a tautology. If we force apart our notion of the political and the legal and say, no, the state is primarily a political order, a political organization, then it becomes a real and significant question how far the state is subordinated to law, how far the state is subordinated to the due requirements of law. And Kim Shepherd was saying how much the shadow of West European ideas or old European ideas was falling over the conduct of the Polish the Hungarian Constitutional Court, and Martin Krieger has been writing similar things and similar but different things about the response to law in Poland and in other parts of the former Soviet Empire. The idea that a change should come about, that the state should aspire again to become a Rechtsstaat, is important and is part of the common stock of contemporary ideas. And if it is true that there genuinely is a possibility of conceptual distinction, then it's also possible that there can be the kind of practical distinction and practical influence that makes a real difference. And when we take the gross cases of, say, Hungary or Poland before 1989 and these countries now, or West European countries then and now, there are many defects in the systems in all these places, but there is a difference between the Unrechtsstaat and the Rechtsstaat. Another side of this denial of equation, which is equally important, is the other way denial. And we had a very interesting discussion of pluralism, critical pluralism, this afternoon in one of the groups. I think that I'm going to be identified in the course of the afternoon as an uncritical pluralist, but at least I'm moving forward. The other idea, which I think is implicit in a great deal of writing in sociology of law until the very recent past, and almost all writing until very recently in the philosophy of law, and enshrined particularly in the closing chapters of Herbert Hart's concept of law, the idea that the law of the state is the primary natural and normal form of law. When you're thinking about law, you're thinking about the state, the other way around from Kelsen's way, because law is what states very particularly have. And other organizations like the Church or the International Football Federation or golf or the European Union, or the International Postal Union. All these other things have law, but in a kind of analogical sense. The paradigm case, the central focal case of law, is the law of the state, of the modern state. And Roger Cottrell was talking about that at a session this morning, and I think saying that it still is, in an important way, a paradigm case for us all. But the more we reflect upon it, again, particularly in Western Europe, the more we need to see how things change and are changing, even in the context of state and quasi-state institutions, because of the development of two things particularly, the European Community is now Community, now Union, and the Council of Europe, and particularly the human rights organs and convention of the Council of Europe. And again, we go back to papers that have been given, Kim Shepherd's particularly, making a state be a Rechtsstaat, bringing the exercise of political power under the control of law, becomes a transformed project when the people who get deciding what the law is don't hold office at the pleasure of that state. And that's what has been the effect of the growth of the Commission and Court of Human Rights, which extends its scope much wider than just the small Europe, the growing but small Europe of the European Union. So here, our common sense of a state that lives up to the law is a state living up to a law which is enshrined in a convention common to the peoples of Europe and reflecting very closely the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the United Nations view of it, the global view of human rights. And at the same time, since 1964, within the European Union, it has been either an acknowledged or a tenderit, a one-sidedly asserted fact that the European communities constitute a new legal order, not merely public international law applicable to states, but a new legal order constituted under the treaties but with its own organs, generating its own ulterior further rules and norms, with its own court adjudicating upon them, and in its own sphere of validity, enjoying supremacy over the laws of each of the member states by the consent of each and all of the member states. So here again, we have the idea of a body of law, neither international law nor national law, transnational, supranational, whatever we shall call it, a distinct legal system which interacts with the state legal orders. So not all the law, and not necessarily the most important law for certain purposes, even when we think in terms of the states and their politics, is law of the state. And this is, I think, something which vitally transforms and will continue vitally to transform our worldview. Especially because, despite all the troubles about mad cows and all these other difficulties which beset us, you know, there used to be a very witty columnist in the Daily Express called Beachcomber, who invented fantastic situations. But he felt at the time of the outbreak of the second great Cod War between Britain and Iceland, that the world had become such a ridiculous place that he no longer had a job to do because the Cod War was something beyond even his fantasy to have thought of. And I think that if poor Beachcomber had still been alive, the great mad cow dispute would have reduced him to even greater breathlessness. Even at the height of this, and the Euroscepticisms here, there, and everywhere, it remains true that it's politically all but inconceivable that any of the member states could secede from the European Union because of the economic disasters that would befall it and would befall any government that did this thing. So there really has been a loss of political power as well as a transfer of legal authority. And that's the sense in which I would want to say that we live beyond the sovereign state in Western Europe at the moment. State sovereignty, as we understood it in the 19th century and through into the 20th, is for these European countries a thing of the past. And what's more, it's not because, or not yet because, there's been a transfer of sovereignty to a sovereign federal union, as eventually happened in the United States. The decision of the German Federal Constitutional Court in its judgment on the Maastricht Treaty indicates that from the point of view of the state legal orders, although much power has been transferred to European organs, they lack the final competence to determine their own competence. That is to say, the state legal order retains an independent ground of decision independently of the European order, which in turn can take its foundation treaties as an independent order. So you have two partial sovereignties at the union level and the member state level, not a compendious altogether sovereignty. We've passed beyond, for the time being, the need to be able to say, where is the all-purpose sovereign? That, I think, is important when we move on to the third theme of the talk, the theme of state, nation, and nationalism. One of the effects of the identification of the sovereign state with the nation state was, in all the places where it happened, the privileging of one particular conception of nationality and belonging and identity over others. In some contexts, this may have worked satisfactorily and completely. In other contexts, it didn't completely work. In Spain, for example, or in Belgium, there was always the problem of the identity of the Basque country, the identity of Catalonia. In Belgium, the distinctiveness of the community of Flanders. In Germany, issues of that kind didn't arise in that form because throughout, with the exception of the Hitler period, Germany has been in different forms a federal union. In countries of that kind, we now increasingly find the importance of a sense of what is sometimes called regional identity, but which to characterize as simply regional identity is often, by the members of the regions who think about this particularly, a kind of a misdescription. Not regional, but national identity in the Basque Nation, in Catalonia, in Flanders, in Scotland, in Wales, and problematically in all sorts of ways in both parts of Ireland. What are we to do about these conceptions of identity and nationality? Clearly, all over the world, not just in Europe, but catastrophically in some parts of Europe, particularly the Balkans at the moment, people's sense of identity can become a sense of ethnicity and of historical bitterness and hatred, the ground of clashes, the disruption of the ordered politics of discourse and dialogue, the resort to force and violence and genocide. Outside Europe, there are similar tensions. And as various people have pointed out, Gidon Gottlieb in his Nation Against State and Ernest Gellner, the late Ernest Gellner in his last book, there simply are too many nationalities in the world, too many credible claimants to nationhood for states to be able to be dished out to all of them. At the same time, some of the bonds of identity of the old post-1789 sovereign states have withered away. Jeremy Jennings, in the latest issue of Political Studies, points out that the so-called nation state, the so-called sovereign nation state, was in reality the imperial state, constituting an empire overseas, colonizing the rest of the globe and suppressing and assimilating to some extent native peoples indigenous peoples, and absorbing other and different legal, political systems and traditions. Ludovic Kennedy, the television and print journalist, said in 1975, the change which had overtaken the United Kingdom came after the Suez Crisis, with the end of empire. The British enterprise, the enterprise of sustaining a worldwide empire, was over. And people sat there and said, well, what are we now? Britain lost an empire and didn't find a role. And the internal nations of the Union, this never really nation state, this multinational state, with many senses of nationality internal to it, began to rethink itself. And at the same moment as the end of sovereignty appears in Europe, out of the old papal encyclical and, first of all, Christian democratic philosophy, particularly in the German-speaking countries, the idea of subsidiarity is brought back into the mainstream of political debate and discussion, the idea that political decision-making and legal decision-making ought to be distributed at more than one level, several levels. Get decision-making at the level most appropriate to the decision to be made, and always err in favor of lower rather than higher in a relevant hierarchy or stacking up of pluralistic legal orders and political orders. I think that idea of subsidiarity is enormously important for contemporary Europe, enormously important in the United Kingdom at the present time, as part of the discourse of debate about the future of the British Constitution and the reconstitution of this old state as a more fully realized Rechtsstaat, which is the ongoing debate at the present time in the run-up to the coming election in the UK. There are always competing solutions to problems. Here, since you are in Scotland, let me just end upon this point. I was rather asked to do so. It seems to me that the proposition, which is accepted by a very great majority, is that the kind of civic institutions which you have visited in the course of this conference, the legal system, here we have, as it were, the shell of the distinct religious establishment. Down the road in the city chambers, the distinctive local government system with control of an educational system originally shared with the church, which has been historically both distinctive and in its effects, on the whole, rather admired. Most people in this part of the UK would take the view that it is an important test of the soundness of constitutional politics in Europe and the UK, that these civic distinctivenesses and a kind of civic but not ethnic nationalism that goes around them should not merely be preserved as in aspic, but given the conditions of their continuing flourishing in the name of the idea of subsidiarity into the 21st century. There are three projects, all of which I think are commended by that underlying position, although each denies the other's legitimacy in its name. One of them is, and we need to see this clearly, the Unionist project, the idea that the United Kingdom never was, although it sometimes appeared to be, a unitary state. Of the two great legal systems in the history of the world, English law and Roman law, one of them hasn't been, for 300 years, the law of a state. It's only been the law of a part of a state, English law, like Scots law. The United Kingdom has been an interesting patchwork, mixture of a Ständestaat and a constitutional monarchy aspiring to modern statehood, with more a parliamentary than a through-and-through democratic tradition. But as such, it is argued, it has provided the ideal context for celebrating difference in unity. And this belongs further now in the greater unity of Europe. The second project says, no, that was all very well in its time, but we must at least have democratic control of those civic institutions locally. We must have a tenorate, a kind of quasi-federation, a devolution of authority locally. And the third position says that's not going to work. You can't have a half-federated state. Now we've got this confederal union in Western Europe, better to be at least two distinct member states of it, because that's the way to do the democratic guarantee, fulfill the principle of subsidiarity, and sustain the possibility of the Rechtsstaat throughout the different parts. Well, these are local arguments. But I think that what they are also, and importantly, local versions of universal arguments. And what is hopeful, I believe, particularly as we think of these issues of globalization and justice that we've been talking about at this conference, what is hopeful is that if we have stepped beyond the all-purpose unitary sovereign state and begun to search out ways of operationalizing the not yet justiciable principle of subsidiarity, we're going to generate a new world. It might not be as thoroughly pluralistic as some of our critical pluralist colleagues were arguing for today, but it's going to be, I think, an interesting world, and let us hope one which is safe for democracy and for the rule of law.
Well, thank you very much, Neil, for that magnificent tour de force. You've certainly deconstructed the title. We wait to see whether it will be put together, and after the next election, in what way in this country it will be put together. Neil has left us a few minutes before the drinks party, and there are some microphones here if any would wish to ask him questions, which he is happy to answer, or indeed, as he prefers, comments directed towards his topic. The floor is yours, ladies and gentlemen. I think we've stunned everyone into silence. Well, I think we're ready for some refreshment. So without more ado, I declare the plenary over. Thank you, Neil, once again. That's gone. No, they've had enough.
Yes. Was that okay?
Oh. Was that yours?
I don't think so. Somebody else's.